All right, so today for week 14, we're going to finish part B, the second part of chapter 15. This is where we, well, hang on a sec. Let me switch the camera over before I forget. Okay, so this is where we get into, we've talked about comparators, digital to analog. Now we're going to talk about A to D and Schmitt trigger. And hopefully, I will not forget and remember to share one little tidbit with you at the end. It's kind of fun. It's not that critical, but it's fun to know. Okay, so there are different ways to go from analog to digital. And this is known as a ramp or stair step. That's the first approach. So if we took the output of our digital to analog converter and fed it to the minus input of a comparator to some unknown voltage on the plus input, we could start at zero and increment the value until our output showed low, at which point whatever count we're at defines where we are. Okay, so the last count that showed a one or high is the value of the unknown voltage. In this particular case, we have to test every possible value until we exceed the value of the unknown voltage. Now, if we're only talking 4 bits, then we only have to go through 16 combinations. But if we are talking about 8 bits, it's 256. How about a 16-bit converter? Oh, hey, no problem. 65 536 comparisons. Even with a microprocessor running full speed, this is going to take a bit of time to do. And if you said, hey, let's do 24 bits, oh, well, that's only 16 million combinations. That ought to be real fun. It's a very slow system. It's simple as far as hardware and easy to understand, but it takes time. Now, I have seen a variation of that where we charge a capacitor with a constant current. This results in a linear voltage rise on the capacitor, kind of like a sawtooth waveform. Then we just count the number of microseconds or milliseconds to determine what the voltage is. And that works too. We actually, oh God, back in the late 70s, I had a Tektronix IC tester where it actually measured voltage that way. It was quite brilliant. And so if it was plus 5 volts, it might take 256 milliseconds. So each 1 milliseconds might be a rise of 19.6 millivolts. So you can see this is a very time-consuming thing. Accurate, but time-consuming. Now, if you see ramp or stair step A to D converter, know, and yes, you should know this, you probably should put on page 4 a little tick mark here. It's the slowest of all the analog to digital converters. So if the unknown voltage is very low in value, we don't have to do a lot of testing. And if we have to try a whole bunch of combinations, then it's not a good thing. Curiously enough, Sony made a video chip for high def of no less, where they had a bunch of ramp or what we would call stair step A to D. There's a more stair step A to D converters, and they were all running in parallel. So even though it was kind of sluggish and slow, all 1920 pixels on a line were converted at once, and then it just read it out accordingly. It's pretty good for 8 bits, but don't try to do 10 bits. So anyway, and like a 24 bits, look at the number of combination. We need a faster way of doing things. My favorite little thing, and I kind of keep pulling this out a bunch. I'm not going to switch the camera over. There you go. The signal generator had to do it quicker, and so it's just not the easiest way. So you won't find a whole lot of ramp or stair step, but you will find a lot of successive approximation A to D converters. Now try to remember in a binary number 1, double it, 2, double it, 4, double it, 8, 16, 32, 64. Okay, So rather than test every possible value, okay, so imagine that we set this bit high. Is this above or below the voltage we were trying to test? Okay, so if not, is the plus input greater than the minus input is what we're asking. If the answer is no, then turn off the 128 pin. If yes, leave it turned on. So we try a one, everything is zeros. Put a one here. Okay, are we greater or not? Well, no, we're not, so leave the one. If we are greater, turn it off. Now put a one here at the 64 bit. Okay, is that greater? If yes, leave the pin turned on, otherwise turn it off. Then we're going to do the same thing for the 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, and 1 pins. Each test divides the range in half. So how many tests do we have to do? Only 8 steps. So is 8 faster than potentially 256? Well, yeah, of course it is. So it's much faster because we're kind of dividing the range down. So here it is, half. Is it above this or below it? Well, if above, we're going to divide in half. Okay, if below it, we're going to divide in half. And then whatever's left, we divide that in half and so on. Even a 16-bit value just takes 16 steps, 24-bit value, 24 steps. Now, for the majority, and that's the key word, of applications, successive approximation is the technology of choice. And it's reasonable, it's fast, it's not too complex. So basically, that's a pretty good way of going about it. If we are talking about doing successive approximation, say for a rapidly changing signal like high def video, it's too maybe too slow. Okay, so we need the fastest possible converter. It's a good compromise, but it's not as fast as the flash A to D converter. Okay, now a flash A to D converter, here we go, or maybe I should just highlight that guy. What we do is we put all the comparators in place. We have a priority encoder, and that will give us our output. Now, the best way to look at this is, here's all the comparators. They will feed instantly to the exclusive OR gate. And again, if this is one and this is one, the output is zero. If this is one and this is one, and notice from lowest voltage to highest voltage. But when we get to a point where, okay, if this is zero and this is zero, that's zero. Okay, but if this is zero and this is one, we've reached the critical point, then this outputs the binary pattern for our 3-bit encoder, a one here, and everything else is, these are pull downs, so these are zeros. That's kind of a simplified look at the circuitry. Okay, now, here's the thing. With our 3-bit encoder, we need only one less than a number of possible combinations, 7 comparators. For 8-bit, 255 comparators. You want 12 bits, 4096. You want 16 bits, 16535 comparators. You're going, oh, wow, can't do that. Oh, no, 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 they do it. If you're willing to pay the price. Okay. The big deal here is the flash A to D comparator is testing every single value at one time. And the highest value that is low, well, that's going to be the output. The priority encoder takes care of that. You don't need to worry too much about the exclusive OR gates or anything. But it's fast. And, you know, we can do this. Now, in terms of, say, you're looking at an analog device price, and this is, by the way, keep in mind this is written in 2017, So quantity 1,000, 8-bit, 250 million samples per second. That's pretty fast. Can be as low as 1690, but if you want to go up, say 5 million samples per second, now we're talking $36. Now, if you want to move up to 12 bits at 2.5 gigasamples per second, get ready to open your wallet. Now, remember, these prices are 3 years old. How about 14 bits at 1.25 gigasamples per second? Well, you know, okay, that's 693. Now, fast A to Ds do exist in the 16, 18, and 24-bit range. But practically speaking, 16 bits is the maximum speed as the time of writing. Now, I put a little web link here, so let's have a little bit of fun, okay? I'll talk about those in a bit. Let's see if this page will come up or not. This is right now today. Oh, yeah, okay. And we can't find the page, so I'm sorry. Let's see. High speed. Let's see what it tells me. Subcategories, blah, blah, blah. Oh, it's going to take me too long to find it. My apologies. It's there somewhere. But it's just going to take too long to find it. I will get to those YouTube videos in a bit, so hang in there with me. So the link really sort of kind of gets you there, but it's changed. I'll have to update it in the new version. Now, as we get to higher bit depths, and this is, what are we on, page 6, there's a problem that we have to face, and that is, it's called jitter. We'd love to have an oscillator be exact. In other words, the time between one pulse to the next never varies. But unfortunately, there's a slight oscillation within the oscillation. Sometimes the pulses are closer together, sometimes further apart. And this is called jitter. Now, you can think of it like we're kind of a slight FM oscillation around the frequency we want it. So you would say, hey, a 1 megahertz crystal should be exactly 1 million cycles per second, but it could be off slightly. And that's, you know, about 100 hertz off, but, you know, and there could be a little bit of fluctuation. And by the way, the temperature can vary the frequency slightly too. And of course, there can be oscillation. You know, and it could be fast or it could be slow. So 1/10 of a second jitter or less is considered faster, but anything longer than a 1/10 of a second is considered slower. So even a tiny, tiny shift of 1 nanosecond might seem only minor. You know, after all, you're going to read slightly early or slightly late, and you get like 0.1%, which would be 1 out of 1,000. But when you're dealing with 8 bits, it doesn't matter. With 24 bits, that becomes very significant. You get a sample, but you get it at the wrong time, and so your reading is slightly off. So you're not getting a true 24-bit sample. Okay, so being off by even 2 nanoseconds, you end up with some trouble. Okay, so the step size is this, but what I say this error could be, I didn't specify exactly, but you get the idea. Now, 8 bits doesn't matter much. 16, we're starting to matter here. It can matter quite a bit. You know, so even though the plus or minus 1 nanosecond might give us 12.566, say, just say 12.6 microvolts. Well, 12.6 microvolts is nothing with 8 bits. Okay, it might affect it a little, but only by a single bit. But 24 bits, whoa, that's huge. It kind of renders it less than 24 bits. Okay, so jitter is a serious thing. So you're using a lot of bits, and you are trying to make sure it's accurate. You know, hey, with a 24-bit sample, that's 105 times our step size. So it would render the lower 7 bits as totally meaningless. Okay. So we have to go to extreme conditions to make sure the oscillator is as stable as possible. And they might things like shield the oscillator, put it in a temperature-controlled chamber, and so on. Okay. Just be aware of that if you end up working in aerospace or you end up working where you have a recording industry and things have to be really accurate. Well, what about that cheap audio card you bought? Will it be accurate? Maybe not. You know, it's just a numbers game. And maybe it won't be. Okay, so we now switch gears. We're going to go to page 6 to the Schmidt trigger. And we get that paragraph up there. Now, if we had a comparator and we had the output divided by 2, so basically when this is a certain positive voltage, half of that, let's say this is output is 12 volts, this would be 6 volts. Minus 12 volts, then this will be minus 6 volts. So on the positive side, To get this above our limit here, we would have to go for at least higher than 6 volts. Now the output will switch, and we have to go, and going below the plus 6 volts isn't enough. You have to go all the way down to the minus 6 volts. Okay, now the beauty here is with a comparator, a straight comparator, you have a reference voltage here, you have the input voltage. If it just bounces above and below that, has a little bit of noise spike, then this thing is going to go high, low, high, low, high, low. But if you have a Schmidt trigger where it crosses a boundary and you've got to go all the way to the other extreme before it switches, now that little bit of high-low noise here isn't going to matter here or here because you got to go really a long distance. So the Schmidt trigger is very good for dealing with noise. And so you could use like a LM324, you know, and set the plus input to 2 volts every time, minus input, and just that tiny little fraction above that would be enough. So this is kind of a good way of dealing with random noise spikes. So with this, using the conditions I described, the trip points, in other words, a plus 5 volts and so on, would be 0.25 volts and 1.75 volts. Okay, so this particular circuit on page 6. So you have to raise up to 1.75 to trip and drop below 0.25 to trip the other way. Now, this particular thing is known as hysteresis. And that really is the secret of it. That hysteresis, the difference between the upper trip point and the lower trip point, that's the hysteresis in a Schmidt trigger. So I do ask read through here at page 7. Learn about it, and say we were trying to measure time with a 60 hertz input. Now, because you have motors, switching devices, you have a lot of electrical noise on 60 hertz. But if you have a Schmidt trigger looking at it, all those noise spikes on this sine wave are going to be ignored by the Schmidt trigger. It's something we use a lot. And so the hysteresis allows us to block out noise. So I suppose the final exam question is, what is it that makes a Schmidt trigger block out the noise? And the answer is the hysteresis makes it possible. Now, we discussed Nyquist theorem already. Sampling and playback. We discussed Nyquist theorem already, and if you want to review it in chapter 13, if we play back a signal, say we have a, we end up with a stair step reproduction. No matter how many bits you have, you still have a stair step. I suppose you have enough bits, then each little stair step becomes very small. So basically, we're talking about CD reproduction, where the sample rate is 44.1 kilohertz. The third order harmonics are above the hearing range, but at lower sample rates, like 6 kilohertz, the third order harmonic would be 18 kilohertz. And this generates a kind of a high-pitched noise that you would hear in it. So a low-pass filter would be required to remove any noise due to the harmonics. The thing is, we don't want to eliminate the six kilohertz sample rate. We want to eliminate anything above the 6 kilohertz. So 18 kilohertz is the noise. All right, that's page 707 of chapter 15. I did want to share a little bit of an add-on here. And I was going through, you know, I, like everybody else, I screw around on YouTube. Believe it or not, there is a $20 oscilloscope kit. This was reviewed back in January 18, 2017. And I said, oh God, knowing my luck, it won't exist today. No, you can still buy it, but look what happened to the price. It's now down to 17 bucks. If you watch the video, and I probably should give you the El Cheapo oscilloscope link so you can kind of see it. It's not great, but and the kits usually come, let's see if I can show you. They pre-solder on the surface mount stuff, whereas you have to solder in all the switches and the through hole stuff on the components. Kind of looks like a fun kit. Remember, you get what you pay for, so if you buy one, and it's not going to be very good. Another thing I came across, this is really cool. Whether you have a FET, a diode, a regular transistor, a MOSFET, or even a resistor or capacitor, this guy tests it. Is it extremely accurate? Now, this is already pre-built, okay? Go to the page. It's only 20 bucks, and oh, well, let's look. Mostly good reviews, but I'm just curious. I forgot to look at this guy. Okay, the oscilloscope is mostly good reviews. So anyway, on this guy, it's about 20 bucks. And I'll give you the link to the video. It's kind of a, it's not super accurate. Remember, you get what you pay for, but I will leave a link to it. If you're interested, it has nothing to do with our class. It's not a requirement, but for those of you who like playing around with electronic stuff, kind of a fun device to have. It's good for ballpark measurements, but I wouldn't hold it too much accuracy there. Okay, with that, that wraps up the chapter. Next week, I do have some new material I'm going to present. Because of the COVID-19, I decided to change the lecture a little bit. But anyway, I'm going to write the handout and have it ready for you next week. So wishing you all have a great weekend. Take care and be safe out there.